Hello, my name is Charles Bedord. Are you a sports fan? Have you ever wondered about the backgrounds and dreams of professional athletes? If so, stay tuned to learn about the work and the world of professional baseball from the player from the San Jose Giants.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors, and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years of our lives. The name of our program is inspired by a quotation from Robert Browning. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be, the last of life for which the first was made. Now, sit back and enjoy a program made especially to provide seniors with useful information, plus some lighter moments to brighten your day.
Our guests today are Linda Pereira, who is Director of Player Relations from the San Jose Giants, and a player, Skylar Strasmo, who is an infielder and outfielder for the San Jose Giants, who, by the way, I should say, are now in first place in the California League. Welcome to The Better Part. I'd like to ask my first question to Linda. Linda, can you tell us a little bit about the San Jose Giants and who they are?
The San Jose Giants are the high Class A affiliate of the San Francisco Giants. And in the minor league structure, it's San Francisco's the major league team, Fresno's the AAA team, Norwich, Connecticut, the AA team, San Jose, the high A team, Augusta, Georgia, the low A team. Our rookie team is Salem Kaiser in Oregon. And we have a team in Arizona, in the Arizona League for rookies.
So it's quite a big organization then.
Yes, it is.
I'm impressed with that. Can you tell us a little bit about your role with the San Jose Giants?
Well, my role is taking care of the players. I take care of all the travel, plan the meal money, make the hotel reservations, the bus schedule, and I do the host family program. I find host families for all the players. I spend the San Francisco Giants money, so that's the fun part.
Well, that's a good situation to be in. Can you tell me a little bit how long you've been with the Giants, and how did you get into the baseball business?
I've been with the Giants, or with the San Jose baseball team, over 40 years. I started when I was in the sixth grade, believe it or not. My brother was the bat boy for 6 years, so I would always go out to the park when my mom dropped him off, and my dad had, you know, advertising and season tickets for his restaurant. So they said, "You're here so early, we might as well put you to work." So I've just never left.
Okay, well, that's very, very interesting. Skylar, can you tell us a little bit about yourself? Where did you grow up, et cetera? What was your background?
Well, I guess I grew up in Alberta, Canada.
That's interesting.
Grew up in a really small town of 60 people, graduated with 16 kids in my graduating class, 250 kids in our whole school, kindergarten through 12th grade. And I grew up, like I said, in a little rural farming community, and just started developing a passion for the game at a young age.
Well, that's interesting. Now, Canada, I suppose when we think of Canada, one of the things we think about is hockey. And how and when did you start to develop an interest in baseball?
Well, like you said, hockey, being from Canada, I mean, if you're a Canadian kid, you have to play hockey. And I played that growing up for, you know, I think about 9 years. But baseball, my dad, he was a baseball player when he was younger. And he was in some softball leagues. And I remember following his team around, being the bat boy, and just, I thought, man, I want to be like my dad. Who doesn't?
That's interesting. Does baseball have a big presence in Canada?
I think more and more now. When I was younger, I mean, I guess I'm still young now, but when I was a kid, hockey was definitely number one. But now, with more Canadian baseball players in the major leagues, it's getting to be more Canadians starting to...
Are you a fan of the Toronto franchise?
When I was younger, yeah. You know, they'd won those World Series in 92, 93. I remember Joe Carter hitting his home run, running on the bases. But, you know, but right now I'm definitely a Giants fan.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay. So you became interested in playing organized baseball rather than just a hobby type of baseball about when?
Well, I remember my dad was a coach. I'd skipped T-ball. He was kind of the director of our coach pitch or parent pitch program. And I think I was around 5 years old. He, you know, enrolled me and my two sisters in just a local parent pitch league.
I see. And this is where the parents, I mean, I'm an ex little league coach myself, and this is when the parents, did the parents get down on one knee and throw the ball in?
Yeah, I guess it depended on the skill level of each kid, but yeah, the parents were on one knee, either throwing underhand for the, you know,
for the
kids that just started playing the game, or overhand from a little further back, and, you know, for the kids that were a little more advanced. But yeah, that was coaches pitching early on for sure.
Well, I've got to ask you this question because I said, as an ex-coach of small children, sometimes, you know, when they break into baseball and they go out and play catch with their father or play catch with the coach, sometimes they'll miss a ball and they'll get hit in the nose or hit in the head. And so maybe you never had this happen to you, but were you ever afraid of the ball initially as a child?
Well, I think every kid at a young age, you're going to be afraid of getting hit by the ball. But I remember my dad telling me, I mean, if, you know, catch the ball, get your glove up there. Don't let it hit you in the face. And if the ball's going to come at you, you're going to do everything you can to either catch it or get out of the way. But, you know, early on, I think I was probably a little scared of the baseball. But as I got older and, you know, the coaches told me, if you get hit by the ball when you're up at the plate, you're on base. So, you know, it's just part of the offensive scheme.
Okay, so you probably grew up with your, you know, bumps and bruises too and so on. How about standing up there at the plate and watching that pitch come in? That can be kind of intimidating, can't it?
Well, I mean, yeah, early on, like I said, you know, I'm not that big of a guy, and with the pitchers throwing the ball, obviously, that if it hits you, it's going to hurt. But, and even now, so too, I mean, we have guys in our league throwing, you know, upwards 95 miles an hour, and you just have to tell yourself they're going to throw it over the plate to be a strike, but if it does happen to come at you, you just got to be ready for it and roll in, and hopefully it hits you in a good spot.
I remember last time I was at the San Jose Giants game, there was one of these pitch speed timers outside the stadium. And I always thought, big guy, I can throw a ball pretty fast and pretty hard and so on. And I went out there and tried it, and I couldn't get it over 65 miles an hour. I was just amazed. I can't imagine throwing 95 miles an hour.
Well, I think a lot of it's just God-given ability with guys that can throw 95 miles an hour.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what it is with the tendons or ligaments in their arms, but, you know, some guys definitely are blessed with a strong throwing arm. I'm not one of them. That's why I'm not a pitcher.
Now, you just had an incident the other day. Didn't you have a player get hit by a ball?
There was a player. Well, I know Joe Martinez with our big league team. He was hit in the head. He was a pitcher. Just got hit in the head by a line drive, and I think he's still on the rehab trail. I'm also a player in Double A in our system as well. Recently got hit.
I see. That's too bad. Looking back again to your childhood, I mean, when I say childhood, I mean ages up through high school and so approximately. Would you classify yourself as a good player or a great player? And the reason I ask that, I think many times we think of professional people who make it to the professional level, they must have been just really great players, you know, all the way through grade school, high school, etc. Is that the case, or and how would you rate yourself in that?
Well, early on, I mean, I was probably one of the better players. I wasn't really the best growing up. A lot of guys, you know, at a younger age, whoever develops physically faster is going to be a better player. And I was always a smaller guy, so I really didn't throw the hardest, didn't run the fastest, didn't hit the furthest.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, just through hard work and, you know, just the love of the game, wanting to get out there and play hard every day, I guess I just weeded myself out, just kind of leapfrogged some of the other guys, and just been really fortunate to be playing professional baseball now.
Okay, well, that's good. So you're doing what you love then.
Absolutely.
What did you, when you first expressed interest in becoming a professional baseball player, can you tell us a bit about what your friends and your parents thought of that idea? Were they open to it and supportive, or did they kind of think, you should be a hockey player or something?
Yeah, well, you know, being from Canada, most of my friends thought their ticket out was going to be an NHL hockey player, and I was one of those kids too early on, but I realized, with my size, it probably limited me in hockey. And you know, being from a small school, I played basketball and volleyball and hockey, and then baseball as well.
Okay.
And I decided that baseball is probably my best ticket to go, you know, see the world and, you know, hopefully get college paid for, and that's what it did for me.
Okay, good for you. And was your family surprised when you made that choice, or they kind of saw that coming, did they? Or?
Well, they were really supportive of me, and same with my friends too. They thought, you know, whatever you want to do, if it's be a professional baseball player and go to college to play baseball, or if it's to be a rancher like my dad, my family has a business. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're just supportive of me or whatever. They weren't really, I wouldn't say they were that surprised. They're just really supportive of me and thought, if that's what I want to do, go for it.
Well, yeah, that's very fortunate, because I think sometimes families can look at any area of professional sports and say, boy, that's a high risk option. I mean, you have to be so good, you have to be so talented. Be ready to do something else if you have to. Did you ever get that kind of reaction?
Oh, for sure. They definitely said, you know, make sure, you know, when you're looking for a place to go to college, make sure it's a reputable college with,
right,
you know, take some classes that'll help you out. And, you know, I've luckily for me, I did end up graduating with graduating university, and so if baseball doesn't work out now, say I get injured or they, you know, the Giants release me, I still have a fallback plan of.
So you actually have your a 4-year degree from a university.
Yep.
That's great. Which school did you go to?
I went to a junior college right out of high school for 2 years in Kansas City. Mm-hmm. And then after that, I was recruited to play at Southern Arkansas University.
I see.
It's a Division II school in Magnolia, Arkansas. Mm-hmm. And broke my hand my first year of school there and took a medical red shirt. So I was able to play an extra 2 years. So I went to school there 3 years and completed my degree.
I've got to ask you, just for people who may not know that term, but you hear it a lot on TV. Could you explain, what is a red shirt?
Well, I know a lot of times you see it more in football. Guys out of high school going to play for a big time football program, mm-hmm. they'll get a red shirt, which means they sit out a season. They go to class, but they don't play on the field. And so they learn the offense or defensive schemes of playing. They get, you know, get their feet wet with their schoolwork. They get a year stronger in the weight room. And that way they'll be more prepared to play for their next 4 years of school.
Okay, interesting, because like I said, it is a term you hear all the time, and you know, it took me a while to learn what that really meant, and thank you for explaining that. Linda, could you tell us how your family reacted when you went into what I termed earlier the baseball business? Were they surprised, supportive, or what was their feeling about that?
Well, I don't think they were surprised, because I was there every day with my brother, and mm-hmm. so through starting in sixth grade, I mean, it's the only job I've ever had my whole life. So they've been very supportive, and you know, we've housed players. One year my mom and I saw over 200 games, because we went on the road. We'd go to Giants games, A's games, R games. So they enjoyed it. They thought it was fun for me.
Okay, so they supported your choice and were really behind you. Mm-hmm. Okay, good enough. Good. Skyler, what can you tell us a little bit about your first minor league game? What was it like? Or your first, I'll say, no, I shouldn't say minor league, but your first professional game. What was going through your mind, and what was it like? What happened?
Well, the biggest thing for me was, you know, even before my first game, it was a tryout. I went to a tryout with the Giants, and they thought, well, they said, we'll send in the film work and see if we'll sign you. And so when they signed me, they thought, okay, we're going to fly out there the next day. And so I flew out to Arizona. I mean, I didn't know what to expect. And they put us up in a hotel. And I just remember the first time I got there, the first action I saw in the games, I was just surprised there was, you know, everybody there was good.
Like, right.
There was no weak players on the field. And also, you know, being from Canada, there's no Spanish-speaking people. It's all English.
Oh,
and,
okay.
And with our team down there, there's a lot of players from Latin America, Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, Venezuela, that were Spanish-speaking. That was new to me, too, just picking up the Spanish language.
Do you speak some Spanish now? Or?
First of all, you learn words that you shouldn't learn early on, I think, being around the baseball field. But
well, that's Spanish or English, either way.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, I guess I picked up a little bit, you know, just one words. I definitely couldn't hold a conversation in Spanish, though. So.
What was your first professional at bat like, and what happened?
Wow, it was 3 years ago. I don't remember my first at bat. I remember some memorable at bats I've had, though. Even this spring training, I got to face Randy Johnson in a an inter-squad game. And that was, I know that was probably the highlight of my career almost. Mm-hmm. Just getting to face a, you know, a future Hall of Famer, that was really exciting for me.
Yeah, he's what, 6'7" or something like that?
He was pretty big. He looks even he looks even bigger in person compared to TV.
I see. But again, were you nervous and intimidated, or you know, being the mindset of a professional athlete, were you just very confident in yourself when you got up there to the plate?
Well, I think to be a professional athlete, to be, you know, in any line of work, you got to be confident in your abilities and,
right.
and know that, you know, I can play. I, you know, just hopefully give it my best effort. And, you know, I really wasn't that nervous. I just thought, I've been here. I've played baseball my whole life. It's mm-hmm. just another game, just another
right.
bat, and, you know, play hard and hope for the best.
Okay, well, that's a good, healthy attitude, extremely good. What do you like most about playing for the San Jose Giants?
Wow, the players probably. I mean, just the people you get to meet on your own team, and like players from all over the place, like I said, and just how everybody's got their own story of where they come from and how they're here.
Right.
And it's so unique how, you know, myself being from Canada or other players from, you know, Latin America or Pennsylvania or Texas, wherever, just, you know, how their story of how they grew up and how they got recruited and signed, and mm-hmm. and now that we're all on this same team. It's pretty unique when you think about how we're all from everywhere and still here.
Now, do players, after they, let's say, go from single A to double A, triple A, and hopefully into the majors, do they keep track of the people that they started out with? Or?
Oh, for sure. I know the guys that I signed with at, in 2007, I'm still in contact, have them on my cell phone, and we'll send each other text messages,
or right.
give each other phone calls just to see how guys are doing, or if they have a good game, congratulate them, or, you know, for sure you keep in touch with guys.
I know one of the things that people like about going to the San Jose Giants games is that they have a lot of opportunity to meet the players and interact with the players. Do you enjoy that?
Oh, I love it.
Excuse me, not I mean meet and interact with the fans.
It's a great thing for us players too, because, you know, I remember when I was a kid, going to games, even high school games, college games, and professional, I thought, man, the coolest thing would be for an athlete to sign an mm-hmm. autograph for me or to talk to me, and just, you know, being able, you know, the fans uh-huh. being right close, they, because I remember when I was a fan of baseball, I still am a fan, but right. when I was that fan asking for autographs, I would have did anything for an autograph, and now, you know, I just love giving time to the fans. And
that's wonderful. I know I've got a son who's now in college, but he always enjoyed going up, meeting the players, and so on. That was a big highlight for him. Linda, what do you like the most about your position as director of player relations?
I think just meeting all the, like Skylar said, meeting all the guys and mm-hmm. finding out all the different stories and interesting little parts of their life and how they did get there, and just, you know, maintaining those friendships. I mean, I'm still friends with lots of players, even mm-hmm. from when I was, like I said, in the sixth grade. I'm still in contact with some of those people, and, you know, going to weddings and hearing about new babies and all that good stuff.
Wonderful. Now, the kind of the nastier question, what do you like the least? I just have to ask this too, because everybody's got favorites and unfavorites, and
I think it's like something that happened this week. It's sad when people get traded or released. Or I was telling Skylar on the way here today that I had to take Scott Barnes to the airport at 4:30 in the morning this week, and we were turning into the airport and just hearing him say, "Wow, I think it just sunk in that I was traded, and I'm going to a whole new clubhouse today and a new organization." And you know, it's sad when guys leave, and you've established a good friendship, or
right,
or your friends get released or something. And
so when they move up in the
that's
program,
the joy.
It's a joy too. How about you, Skylar? What do you like the least about? Honestly, now, honestly.
Well, I don't think people really understand how, you know, how time consuming it is. I mean, we've this month of August, or July, we've had one day off. We mm-hmm. play, you know, every day but one this month, and, you know, we get on the bus, and some of it, we travel in places like Modesto, Visalia, Bakersfield,
yeah,
Rancho Cucamonga, Lancaster, down south. It's bus drives are really long. It's been a long time in the buses. The weather's pretty hot for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I just say, you know, it is time consuming. It's every
right.
day, and even if you don't feel your best, you still got to go out there and, like I said, like every job,
And you have to be fond of buses.
Yeah, you get used to the buses and cramp sitting close quarters with your teammates.
Linda, I know one of your premier items is being founding a host family organization for the players. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, in 1982, we were an independent team, which meant that we had no major league affiliate. So we had independent players, or some teams would give us two or three players, and we had to pay those players. So we had to find affordable housing for players. And in this market, apartments are very expensive.
Right.
So I don't know. I just got the idea of maybe finding host families and players living with host families. So it's just something that's mushroomed into a really great thing. I've said this before, you don't open up your home, you open up your heart as well. And it's really great. I mean, like Skylar said, they had one day off in the month of July, and we had a golf tournament that day, so they really didn't have a day off. So when they do have a host family and they get to come home and maybe have a home-cooked meal or just some downtime with the family, I think it really helps them relax and make life easier for them. And none of our host families charge money, so they get to save a little bit of money. And we give them a season pass and a parking pass, and we do different activities for them. So,
I see. How many host families do you have?
Well, I have 28, but now I have 31 players. So we're getting two new players today. So I'm actually looking. I'm always looking for more.
Right.
And you know, you have to make sure, just because you say you want to be a host family, you have to make sure the personalities mesh. You don't just be a host family and go to somebody who isn't going to fit in with your lifestyle.
Skylar, do you stay with the host family?
Yeah, we, Linda, like she said, I guess hooked us all up with host families, and I've got a really nice family in the South Bay area with two kids, and like she said, it's really nice coming home from a game, or, you know, even before the game, hanging out with the kids, and maybe play ping pong in the backyard, or play catch with the kids. It's just nice to have a family atmosphere when all you do is baseball, and it's nice to just get away from that sometimes.
Do you have some particular fond memories or thoughts about the host family then?
Well, I like Linda said, she's always looking for host families, and I think as good as it is, you know, it's probably neat for the host family to have a player staying with them, but for us too, it's really nice because, you know, we really appreciate the host family, what they do for us.
Good. Skylar, if you were to give some advice, good advice to high school or college students who want to be professional athletes, and this doesn't have to be just baseball, it could be any type of any realm of professional sports, what would that advice be?
Man, I just have to be work hard. I mean, always give your best. I remember, you know, a college coach saying, you know, hustle is free. If I can get my grandma out here and work hard, so there's no reason why I can't get my best effort every day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's the thing. If I get my best every day and I make it to the big leagues or don't make it to the big leagues, I can sleep at night knowing that I've worked my hardest, I've done everything I can, and I just have to leave the rest
up. What would your advice be about continuing through and actually getting a college degree? Would you say that, you know, there's risks involved with that too, injury risks and so on, you know, playing for 4 years for college before wanting to go pro? But now you do have your degree, and how do you feel about the risks versus benefit of that?
Well, if I had the opportunity at a high school and would have been drafted, you know, for sure it has to be life-changing money. And I know a lot of the guys, you know, on our team or within professional baseball, if they get offered $1 million out of high school, that's pretty tough to turn down.
Yes.
But for me, I wasn't drafted or signed until I was out of college, so I really had no other option but to go through college and, you know, get my degree so I have something to fall back on when baseball's done.
And Linda, what would your advice be to people who wanted to go into a career in professional sports, and what would you tell them to do, and what would you tell them to keep a mindset about?
Well, I think I agree with Skylar 100%. Always do your best. I think you have to go to school. I mean, even if you're a player, you have to go in the off season or whatever, because you're not going to be a player forever. You can't play 140 games when you're 60 years old, so you need something to fall back on. So the education part is really, really important. And I think, like, if you want to get into sports management or whatnot, you still have to go to school, learn sports management. And if you're starting in the minor leagues, you have to learn how to sell advertising, season tickets, group packages, anything to make the whole of the organization better.
Well, I think you brought up an interesting point here, is that there's more career opportunities in professional sports than just being the athlete. That there is a number of business professions that are required to support a sports franchise. And in fact, I know up at the University of Oregon, they have a very well-developed MBA program in the area of sports management. Well, I'd really like to thank Linda and Skylar for coming today to give us a look into the world of professional sports. Skylar, I want to thank you so much for taking time out from your practices and your travels and baseball to come and talk with us today. You certainly gave us a very interesting and educational and entertaining look into the world of professional baseball from the standpoint of a baseball player. Thank you so much.
It's been my pleasure. Enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
And Linda, thank you so much for coming. I know you had to deal with some heavy traffic coming up here and some traffic problems, and we really, really appreciate your efforts and arranging for Skylar to come up and join us today. And thank you for your perspectives on some of the more managerial front office aspects of professional baseball. Really enjoyed it.
Well, thank you. I hope that you and all your viewers will be out at the ballpark very soon and see us bring a championship to San Jose in 2009.
Plan on it. We hope that you have enjoyed today's program and found it informative and interesting. If you would like to suggest a topic or a guest for the better part, you can always reach us at the Cupertino Senior Center. And the phone number there is 408-777-3150. Again, 408-777-3150. You can learn more about us and order a copy of this program or one of our many programs by visiting our website. The website is www.thebetterpart.com. The Better Part has many of its programs available through the Santa Clara County Library System. And The Better Part also has selected programs available on YouTube. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.